Muchas gracias. Es un gran placer estar con ustedes aquí. No se preocupen, no voy a hablar español en por la eternidad. Pero yo conozco, he hablado español hace 20 años. Entonces puedo entender mucho, pero no puedo dar una charla de cosas técnicas en español. Entonces voy a hablar en inglés, pero es un placer estar aquí con ustedes. Me encanta Bolivia y Bogotá. Tengo un amigo de Bolivia aquí, otra persona que trabaja con ustedes, con nosotros en QuantSight. Y me gusta Latinoamérica, pero nunca he venido aquí antes. Es mi primera vez. So I'm really glad to be here. It's my first time being here in Latin America and certainly in Colombia, Bogota. So I'm going to talk a little bit today about the community, about how we make more, kind of some of the things I've been a part of for a while, and see if we can hopefully inspire some of you to get involved and do more. It's amazing what you can do with persistence and a little bit of action and 1,000 of your closest friends helping you to do it along the way. The real key, though, is to keep active. So I'm passionate about a lot of things. I like open source, but I love math. I love science. I got started in science and math. That's where I still love it. I still do math for fun. I do a lot of things that I really enjoy. Later in life, I became aware of the need for entrepreneurship. I fell in love with entrepreneurship because I realized that that's the way to discover new ways to please people, to give people products and services that make them excited. And that's really the key to progress, is when a lot of people are delivering products and services that other people like and then partake of and buy and participate in voluntarily. So I was convinced intellectually of the need to be an entrepreneur. And so that kind of left academia in order to be an entrepreneur. But I really started in academia, and I still love it. I started as a scientist studying backscatter off of the ocean, off of the earth, really. But my research was on wind speed. So we'd take little backscatter that would come in the satellite, and then from that infer wind speed. It's amazing you could do that. I didn't believe it when I saw it, but it works to some resolution, to some amount of uncertainty. So I did that for a while, and this was using Perl and using tapes and using MATLAB and using kind of a lot of tools that were cool, but not as fun as when I learned Python. And I learned Python, so I knew what I was doing with computational science. Then I found Python when I was a graduate student studying biomedical imaging, MRI, ultrasound, and trying to get information from electromagnetic energy going into the body and trying to come out of it. So it was at the Mayo Clinic, some of the people there I worked with really enjoyed it, but that's where I found Python. And I started to use Python to do my research. And then I saw that Python could be improved. It had a nascent array object called numeric. It had a few libraries out there, mostly links to large-scale codes that people had written. So I started the SciPy project, and I'll talk a little bit about that. I started that basically for my own use. Excuse me. If you look in 1998, 1999 is when SciPy started. And it was basically me needing stuff, and then so, hey, there's some Fortran libraries out there that do what I need. I just need to bind it to Python. And hey, I did it, so I'll share that with somebody else. And so I shared it in a really dumb way. We didn't have GitHub back in the day. We didn't have, there's some pros and cons about that. What we did is we just made a tarball, right? I was on my computer, made a tarball, and then I stuck it on a web page that was really ugly, but it worked, and it just had a link. And then I put a mailing list notification out and said, hey, here's a thing you can download if you want. And guess what? Some people downloaded it. And it was actually really incredible. People in Estonia downloaded it. People in South Africa downloaded it. People all over the world downloaded it. And it really blew me away. It really helped me fall in love with the notion of global collaboration, which open source is. And over the past 20 years, I've watched that global collaboration just expand. And it's amazing how it connects us, much more than anything else I've seen in my life. And so using this, I've been able to connect. It's similar to the way science helps us connect, and science has done this for decades as well. Science helps us connect with everybody on the planet. Open source helped us do that too. Well, as long as you had an internet connection and good power, and there are some places where you don't have that. And so there's still work to do to make sure everybody can participate. And then also you need a little bit of spare time. If you're just basically trying to make ends meet and trying to, eke a living, it's really tough to participate in open source unless you're paid to do it. So that's why I got really interested in figuring out how do we help people get paid to work on open source. So I left Mayo Clinic. I was a professor for a while. I was at the Mayo Clinic as a grad student. Then I became a professor, and I studied, had my own lab, and I did scanning impedance imaging, and I made a MRI system that was a handheld MRI system. I made an MRI simulator. I learned how to do parallel computing. Really, you know, nothing grand or exciting, nothing I could share with somebody, but just I learned a lot about how to just get some things done. And that was a lot of fun, but more and more, these little side projects I was doing on the side to support my research kind of became what I was doing. So I was writing more SciPy. I was ended up at BYU writing NumPy, and that just kind of led to me doing more coding. And then as I realized the value of entrepreneurship, and I realized that I needed to experiment that, explore that, and figure out how to do that, I left academia. Now I have a big family. I'll show a slide again to talk about them. They're very important to me. My family is a very important part of my life, and supporting them, and I got married pretty young, when I was 22. I was already married, and I have six kids now. And they're an important part of my life. And so it's kind of led to me kind of trying to figure out how do I support them while also giving away software that I write. It's been an important question in my mind. And I've thought through it, don't have all the answers, but have some ideas about how is it that you can write open source, participate in open source, while still giving to your family, while still giving back to the people you care about and the people that are most important to you. And then the benefit of that is that you also bless the lives of the entire planet, and you get basically millions of other friends that you didn't realize you had by giving to them as well. So this is my journey through open source. It started at the Mayo Clinic and then at BYU, and that's where I wrote SciPy at the Mayo Clinic. It came together when I just first got hired by BYU, like with colleagues that I collaborated with. NumPy wasn't written until 2005, 2006. I'm most known for NumPy, but SciPy is why I got started. And I wrote NumPy because I loved SciPy and I wanted to keep it going. And then when I left academia, then I was struggling just to find work. I had to get jobs and I had to work, and I couldn't work on NumPy all the time, and that created some challenges for the project, but it also provided opportunities for other people to step up and contribute to the project. And now there's, you know, hundreds of people that contribute to NumPy's success. So there was some, you know, there's some downsides, but it also, not me not spending all day working at it, left room for other people to come in, because if you're the creator of a project, it's kind of hard for others to get involved sometimes, because you know all the answers and you have to kind of let other people become experts as well and know the answers. So NumPy now is led by, NumPy and SciPy both are led by teams, and I'm an observer. I'm a cheerleader, I'm an advocate, I'm somebody they can talk to if they have ideas, or ideas can be bounced off of me, but they're really in the hands of other people at this point. I worked at a company called NThought. NThought has been behind the SciPy conference in the United States for a long time, and I was there doing consulting, trying to figure out ways to work on NumPy and SciPy, not succeeding. In 2012, started Anaconda, and the whole goal of that, I started a company, Anaconda, was to create opportunities for open source developers and also to hopefully, eventually, make some money that I could then invest back into open source. That's still a work in progress, but hopefully may happen someday. We hired another CEO at Anaconda, and as the ability to contribute to open source kind of shrunk at Anaconda, I started another company, QuantSight, to continue that energy to try to create more companies, create more open source. I'll talk a little bit about that later. But that's my journey. You can see along the bottom, I haven't written all these projects, to be clear. These are all projects that are relevant to data science and analytics that I care about and are interesting to me. But we'll talk about some of them. So I started with SciPy, as you described. And I started with SciPy. It was basically I.O., a project called NumPy I.O. that I started with. And I did it because somebody else shared their work. There was a project called Table.io that was shared by somebody. I was able to cut and paste program. Writing extensions to Python back in the day, it was really hard. Actually, today it's really easy. You can just, you know, do a decorator with Numba or write some Cython code. It's really quite a bit easier to extend Python and make it fast. Back in the day, it was a little bit of work, but somebody had shared their code so I could borrow that. And NumPy.io was that little module. And over the next 2-3 years, I wrote about 10 other modules and just made them available and combined them together in a single download, and then released SciPy, which basically is a distribution of Python masquerading as a library. It's kind of a bunch of things all together in one go. There was a lot learned in that lesson. It's been maintained now for a while, but it has a lot of capability. Now, each of these areas, interpolation, optimization, signals, sparse matrices. Each of these areas also have additional scikits that are out there or other modules that are out there now as the community has grown. But this is, I was really passionate about making it easy for people to be able to do high-level math quickly with a free and open source language like Python. So this was early on in my career. I spent a lot of time with SciPy. I had graduate students work on SciPy. I worked a lot on SciPy. I was active until about 2011. And then when I started Anaconda, it waned. I wasn't as active in SciPy anymore, but I was still a cheerleader and still excited and still eager to cooperate with people that are making SciPy work. It led to me to create NumPy. And NumPy came out of a fracture that was happening in the community. Basically, SciPy was written with something called Numeric, which is the first array object that was in Python when I came. And NumArray was another array object being built. And that's fine to have multiple array objects, except what was happening is people were writing libraries. So there was a library called ndimage that was only available if you had NumArray. And SciPy worked with NumPy. So you had all these high-level libraries that use this one array object, then other high-level libraries use this other array object, and then basically you'd have to copy data between them, and they couldn't share each other's work. So you're basically reinventing the world in two different places. And it was really unsettling. So I spent time writing NumPy to bring together the features of NumArray into Numeric, and it was a project, took about 18 months. I thought it would take four, and it did take four to write the first version, and then to fix all the bugs and respond to community feedback and make sure that it was supporting all the things that the community that existed wanted it to. That was another 14 months. So that's the nature of community work. Community work often is really rewarding, but it is also slower because you're involving a lot of people whose time scales aren't yours and you don't control their schedules. So you basically, it's a lot of communication and with a lot of work. I come up with a triplet. I like to say it's about you lead. You have to lead. You have to do something. The world doesn't move forward if you all just sit there and wait for somebody else. Somebody has to lead. Somebody leads. Then you listen. You listen to what the feedback is you get. You get all kinds of feedback. You have to listen to it. And not just listen, but then learn from it. Learn from it, then iterate again, then lead again. So lead, listen, learn is how you make progress in open source. And it can be painstaking, but it's very rewarding if engaged with patiently. And that's what happened with NumPy. And eventually it got adopted by everybody. Now, fast forward 10 years, and 2015, we actually find ourselves in a very, very similar situation, actually much worse than what happened in NumPy and NumArray. We're in a situation now where we have TensorFlow, we have PyTorch, and we have MXNet, and we have Bormium, and there's literally a dozen array objects now in Python. And so what people are doing is they're building stacks. And last year at PyCon, I went and the PyMC, the Monte Carlo methods. I love Monte Carlo methods. They're actually a very popular approach to Bayesian computing, one I'm very fond of. And there's a project called PyMC3, and it was built on Theano, which was built on SciPy. Theano kind of went out of business. They said, well, we're not going to keep up with what's going on with TensorFlow and PyTorch, so we're not going to do this anymore. And then the PyMC folks said, well, what are we going to do? And they basically decided to go with TensorFlow. So then you have another group that decided to go with PyTorch. And so now you have two of these projects that are both on different array objects. And neither of those array objects actually fully support NumPy and all the things NumPy already does. So we find ourselves in kind of a bit of a mess, actually. There's more money and more people involved, and we're worse off in some cases. Now, we're better off in that there's lots of things to choose from, and you can get a lot done quickly. But we're worse off in that we're not very unified. So there's an interesting opportunity now. You know, NumPy is an array object. It's at the foundation of a lot of things. Anymore, you don't hear about NumPy so much because it's under the covers, which is great. But sometimes people forget that it's used still, and you have to think about what array object am I going to be using in this system. So on top of this, there was an enormous stack, and that stack's been growing over the past several years. Very exciting to watch the growth. I'm just going to briefly go over a couple things you may not have heard of, which I've been involved with over the past 7 years while at Anaconda. Bokeh is a visualization library. There's a lot of them out there now, but Bokeh is really, it's got a great group behind it, a lot of users. It works on Canvas. It doesn't use D3. It's kind of its own D3. It works on the HTML Canvas. There's a JavaScript library. It's actually written in TypeScript now. But it's really good for the Python user who doesn't really want to know JavaScript. They can just type plotting commands in Python, and it shows up in the browser in a JavaScript window. So it's really easy to build interactive, compelling visualizations with Bokeh in the browser using Python. And then we have, so that you can do a lot of things with it. Data shader is a really awesome way to deal with a lot of data. The problem of a lot of data is real. You can't really visualize more than a million elements. Really, that's kind of a lot. More than 100,000 points on a scatter plot in an image starts to look saturated. Doesn't make any sense. So you have to do something. If you have a billion data points you want to plot, you have to do something. And data shader is a rational plotting pipeline. I'm a big fan of Panel. There's a lot of dashboarding solutions that are out there. The Panel team has been hard at work understanding all the details for how do you do dashboards, not only just for exploratory work in Jupyter, but also how do you deploy them as standalone applications. And there's others out there now as well, but Panel deserves a lot of attention. And it's easy to create very large-scale apps with Panel. And it works with all the visualization libraries, including Plotly and Matplotlib and Bokeh. It's not a particular visualization library that it uses. And you can do a lot of things. What's exciting about this dashboarding capability, which a lot of libraries are starting to enable, is that you can work at a high level in a notebook, but then produce applications, at least prototype applications, that then can be used for a department, for an organization, kind of see what you're doing. The hardest part of any data science problem is actually, what do I want to do? What do I really want to do? You kind of have an idea, but it's until you do it and use the data and start getting feedback from domain experts, you don't really know what needs to be focused on. And having a tool like Panel that lets you do high-level dashboarding quickly is very powerful. I was talking the other day and realized that people didn't know about Numba. So who knows about Numba in the audience? Raise your hand. Okay, so the rest of you, be ready to be pleasantly surprised. You can make your code as fast as C. Right, so if you have people who are telling you, oh, you got to use C, C++, or else you can't be fast, you can just kind of smile at them and say, that's not true. I can, with Numba, I can write Python code, and it can compile to machine code, exactly like C++ and C does for you. Now, it's a subset of Python, to be clear, so it doesn't take any Python code and make it fast. But it lets you write Python style and Python syntax, and it can be as fast as C. So very, very awesome project, as simple as @JIT. No Python equals true guarantees you get machine code out of it. But you know, fast is not always the important part. In fact, the reason Python became popular is because fast computation is not as important as fast iteration for humans. Getting people to work faster is actually more important typically. But then when you do need to make it go fast, at the very top of this is from Stan Siebert's talk at SciPy 2019, it's nice to have a compiler. Dask, yeah, who's heard of Dask? A few more people. Dask, basically, who's heard of Spark? Anybody Spark, big data? I know there's a lot more marketing behind that. Cloudera spent a lot of money trying to tell everybody that Java is the way you have to parallelize everything. So it's not true. You certainly can use Spark, and it can do parallelization. But often, Python's a better choice. In fact, what I tell people is if you're using PySpark, if you're using Spark in a Java setting and you love it, great. But if you're using PySpark, stop right now and go try Dask, because you'll probably be happier, and your code will be faster, and it'll be easier to maintain going forward. So if you're using PySpark, go try Dask. Dask gives you the same capability. All right. And I don't know how much time I have, actually. How much time am I supposed to? 15? 15. So I have to end in 15 minutes. Great. So I'll go fast. The impact of all this has been phenomenal. It's been exciting, and in May, I was able to meet the people who made the black hole image. GitHub invited many of us out to meet with folks that made this interesting image of a black hole in the galaxy, and it was fascinating to meet them and to feel their appreciation for the libraries that they depended on, because they used NumPy, they used Matplotlib, they used Jupyter, they used these tools, they used a lot of tools, actually. But they used all these tools, and they were really grateful. And it's exciting to see what bright people do with the tools you provide. And it's amazing. And you can be part of this global collaboration that does interesting things because of it. All of this effort has created impact. And certainly the impact, I believe this large growth has been the machine learning, the AI enthusiasm that's created this incredible growth of the past few years. But it's gotten to the point that Python has surpassed Java and JavaScript in Google search trends. Right? It's only one metric. But it does tell you that it's very interesting to a lot of people. So there's a lot of opportunity. There's a lot of new people coming to Python, a lot of people that don't necessarily understand why things are the way they are, a lot of new libraries being written. So it's an exciting time. It's a time full of some challenges and a time full of some opportunity. There's absolutely opportunities today to do important and meaningful things for the future. Right now, one of the challenges we face is the fact there are many deep learning libraries to choose. I've mentioned a few of these. Now, Chainer, PyTorch, those are kind of the ones I typically recommend. Chainer, because it's built on NumPy and SciPy, they didn't just go off and reinvent another Ray object. So it shows it's possible to build a deep learning framework on top of NumPy. In fact, if you look at what's necessary to do deep learning, you need GPU computation, and you need differentiable programming. You need to be automatic differentiation. Those are the two things that you need to add to the NumPy stack in order to make it possible to use it for deep learning. So Chainer did that. They have CuPy for GPU computing, and there's AutoGrad, and there's a few other automatic differentiation libraries. So you can do it, but it's still kind of, there's still a lot of, we need to come together. We need to figure out how to come together. That's one of the things we're working on, is how do we come together and build an API, at least, that maybe we can all share, so that the high-level libraries don't have to be different. We don't have to have a SciPy for TensorFlow, and a SciPy for PyTorch, and a scikit-learn for TensorFlow. We actually have one high-level library that uses an API that maybe has different backends, so that all of these libraries can then work together. So I want to talk a little about the conference history, and kind of this is the libraries I've been a part of, and then the communities we've been a part of, and talk about how do we get more of this. So the communities have been growing rapidly, and that's awesome, and it's also organic, because the community is people. The community are you. The community are all the people that come together and want to do something. And it's as varied and as organic as people are. So it's been exciting to watch this grow. The very first SciPy conference actually had less than 50 attendees. I remember I was there, and it was a fun time. We didn't realize how big the movement would grow to encompass so many different communities and libraries and people. The first 9 conferences were held in Pasadena, sponsored by Caltech. It was a kind of a tight group of people that worked together on libraries. And then EuroSciPy started in 2008 in Leipzig, SciPy India in 2009 in Trivandrum. There's a picture of me in Trivandrum, my very first time to India. It was an awesome trip, and I hadn't had that picture before, but I grabbed it. SciPy Latin America, I think, started in 2013. This is my first time at SciPy Latin America. Glad to be here. Excited to see the progress and the growth that's happened. There's many, many good things happening in Latin America. And then SciPy Japan just started this year. Of course, there's other projects. There's other. NumFocus was created in 2012 to create a 501c3 foundation, which in the U.S. is a tax-free. It's governed by a community, a community-elected board. And these folks were the folks elected in 2018. The starting group was me and Fernando Perez and John Hunter and Perry Greenfield and Jared Millman, people who had been involved in the SciPy community since the beginning. But I'm really grateful that the community has grown, and there's many, many other people who can participate and get involved. NumFocus sponsors the PyData Conference Series. PyData Conference Series started in 2012 and has been growing rapidly, basically to the degree there are people. Anyone that wants to organize a PyData conference, they just contact NumFocus. There's a team there that helps organize conferences, and you just have to find a venue, basically. A venue, and then they can help you get it going. And because of that, there's been lots of PyData conferences sort of established and growing all over the world, and it's an exciting group of people. I think even in Cordoba, there's been a few in Latin America as well, San Luis and Cordoba. Excited by that. This is my family. Again, this is the whole, all during this work of travel and writing code and doing things for free and then trying to figure out how to pay the bills. It's been an exciting journey. But my family's always been important to me. I love participating in open source software, but I have to do it sustainably. I have to do it while having a job. I have to do it while making money. So that's something I cared about a lot. That's why I started Anaconda. In 2012, Peter Wang and I started Anaconda. The fundamental thing we provided to the world is this easy way to install everything. Conda is a cross-language, cross-platform, general-purpose installation tool. Think Brew, think apt-get, think all these things. It's actually not like pip. In fact, I argue that pip is overused because pip's great for a developer if you're working kind of as a developer, building out some tools. But if you're trying to ship product to end users, you shouldn't be relying on pip. Pip's not your tool. PIP's a tool for developers. For end users, what they want is they want it a simple a package manager, something like Conda, something like Brew, something like apt-get, something that all-encompassing install, Python included, Python plus Java, plus JavaScript, plus Node, plus all the things you need besides just Python libraries. So right now in the community, that's a little oversold, unfortunately. The messaging behind PIP is a little oversold. A lot of people are kind of, oh, I have to use PIP to install things. And you have problems like TensorFlow trying to get installed via PIP. And then you end up with vendored libraries. You end up kind of with, it works a little bit, and then you end up with a mess. And so it is something to be aware of, that there's that we haven't quite settled. But Conda's an alternative, Homebrew's an alternative, AppKit's an alternative. I recommend heavily that you use a distribution like that if you're going to be giving to users, because you'll save them all kinds of pain. And there's 17 million Anaconda users. Conda's a free tool. It's an open source tool. It's a community of users. In fact, I'll talk later about how you build more community and use Conda as an example. Now, QuantSight, we spun out QuantSight, kind of the same team that built Continuum and then gave rise to Anaconda. We left Peter with that Anaconda, and then the rest of us kind of organized and created QuantSight. Of course, all the wonderful people at Anaconda that remain as well. And there's some great people. Damian's here. There's some other great people there. But we started to kind of grow and continue growing the community aspect of what we were able to do at Anaconda. So we see spin-outs. And we see Anaconda and NumFocus as spin-outs of our efforts over the past 7, 8 years. We want to do the same. Want to keep working with the community, build community projects, potentially create new companies, potentially create spin-outs, potentially create other opportunities. I'd love to see and help grow other entrepreneurs. So in fact, that's what we do. We have a QuantSight Labs at QuantSight. It's an open source team. We'd like this to grow to 30, 40 people. It's currently about 8. Most of those are the Spider team. Then we have a few people working on NumPy, as well as URA and some other projects. We want to build a PyData core team. There's a lot of work to do on helping unify the frameworks, the ML frameworks, unify the NumPy ecosystem, JupyterLab, JupyterHub, data catalog standards. We partner with Ursa Labs, we partner with NumFocus, we partner with some of the other groups that are out there as well. QuantSight Initiate is a venture fund. I realize that if we're going to be spinning out companies, we need a way to finance them. And so we've started a venture fund. For those who don't know, venture funds are, you go and get wealthy people as limited partners, and they put money into a fund, a pool, and that pool invests in startups. Early stage startups are especially helping people go from idea to company that can grow and scale and be investable, and kind of understanding the difference between an open source project, an open source community, a company that sells something that can be investable. That's kind of what we specialize in. We help people understand and navigate that maze so they go from idea to products they're selling. So that's something we do as well. So in the last few minutes, I just want to talk about community and how do we get more of it. I'm going to run quickly. I have a bunch of slides here, but I'm not going to go over them all. If you would like later to talk to me about that, I can go into it in detail, because I'm going to talk about an initiative we've just started called Open Teams. So community starts with a group. Like, one thing to remember is that community doesn't happen by just putting something out there and waiting for everyone to type and then things more magically evolve. It always starts with a small group, 1 to 3 people. That's the size of a group that needs to talk high bandwidth together to produce something. Then that something has to find hooks for other people to contribute. And those hooks for other people to contribute are really critical for the growth. And Conda and Anaconda both are examples. Conda started basically with kind of 1 or 2 people working on it. And then those people attracted other people and started to make bug fixes. And Anaconda started with 1 person. But then it's grown. It grew to a large team, and then an even larger team with ConDaForge. Now, ConDaForge is a group of 1,200 contributors, all people in the community who are making packages available in a free repository, and there's currently 8,093 pre-built packages you can get. And they're managed by a community, which has its pros and its cons. Some of it's nice to have something managed by 1 or 2 people. You know everything works together. With a community, sometimes things may not work exactly the way you like, but then it can work. I have a few slides here on how to build more community. I'm going to go quickly. So some great books here. Neuroscience is important. I love neuroscience. You should too if you're trying to work with communities, because actually why we do the things we do has more to do with who we are as creatures with a mind than it does with technology. And so a lot of things, our cognitive biases often play a role. We have to overcome them. We have to educate each other about them. We have to help each other get through them. You've got to stay open. You got to stay open to the ideas that are out around there. You have some great ideas, but other people have great ideas as well. And merging those two great ideas is the beauty if you can accomplish it. You have to have traits and characteristics of like great courage and kindness. Take care of yourself. Dunbar numbers are fascinating. I think everybody who strives to do a steering committee should read Dunbar first and understand that you're not going to be able to build a big community with, once communities grow too big, the mental model you have to have in your head to have high bandwidth communications with everybody in that group is too much. It's more than you can do. We're limited. We're creatures with a limited brain. It's a big brain, but it's still limited, and most of it we use to model each other. At least that's the hypothesis. So there's some important principles of things like brotherly love, things like sacrifice and service, things like trust of every culture. And one of the things I did to create these slides to go to the different cultures and realize the principles of creating community have been with us for a long time, thousands of years, in fact. And they're similar across cultures. And they basically have to do with who we are as tribal humans wanting to cooperate with each other. So how do we take some of those things we've evolved to have, those characteristics that help us work together in tribes, and then scale that to many, many tribes, to the human tribe across 7 billion people? And some of these work, and some of these you have to go farther. Like transparency is one that becomes really important as you're going from one tribe to another tribe. People have to trust, and they have to, and being transparent helps with that trust. They can see that you're not trying to hide something; you're just trying to share, and that can take work. Governance is an important topic. Won't have time to talk about it here, but talk with me after. There's a lot of communities going through, how do we do this? How do we actually be transparent about our governance, but also be productive about our governance and do something so we're not just stalled? And that takes time. And for me, what's important is sustainability, not just sustainability, but thriving. How do we help a community thrive? How do we help people work full-time on open source? Trade is actually important. And a lot of people working in open source don't necessarily appreciate how important it is to have businesses, to have trade, to have people trading. That's actually a very important activity where you determine your desire in the world. You can talk, you can raise your hand, you can express what you care about, but nothing says what you care about more than you pulling out your wallet and giving money to somebody. That tells you what you really care about. And that trade becomes a really important signaling mechanism that people can listen to. And so understanding that and how it works and then how you can participate in it is a key. And it's really a foundation for not only prosperity, but also peace in the world. And I really believe that. So as much, I love open source and I love business and I love both of them. And they work together. And they work together and they can work together. So we've started something to try to help. It's something called Open Teams. I don't have time to go into detail, but I want to just show you an example. And it's early stage, but I invite you to try it out. Open Teams' purpose is we notice these problems. We need the problems of commercial organizations need commitments and support. We notice that open source projects need autonomy and independence. Project leaders don't want to be driven by just a company telling them what to do. They want to understand, kind of do it from passion and from what they care about. Then open source contributors need credit and careers in open source that they can get paid for. So we have a project called Open Teams, and this platform works to ensure open source contributors thrive professionally and financially. It's a website, it's a marketplace at its foundation, but it's also a place to build credit and reputation for open source developers and projects. Early stages, but you can jump in and you can be part of the conversation if you start early. So commercial people, it's a place to find and fund projects to meet their needs, and a place for open source contributors to find funding for projects they care about and initiatives they care about. So developers can go on there and have a profile as a developer or a contributor, not just a person who writes code, but a person who does presentations, a person who does project management, a person who does community engagement or does issue triaging. You can put your contributions and get people to approve that or recognize it or thank you for it. And you can then have a profile that shows your contribution to the world. Then there's projects can show their development roadmap. Projects can say, well, this is what we care about. And kind of understand how much agreement there is or disagreement there is. How much do the project leaders agree? How much do the users agree? How much do the contributors agree? Kind of these three different classes, then organizations that care, what do they think? So a place they can discuss and come up, kind of a voting technique. And then organizations can find and fund projects. So we're just getting started with this. Right now, you can go on Open Teams and build your reputation. Currently, you can thank people for their contributions. You can claim usages. You can say, I use this project, and say what you use it for. And that's information for project leaders. It'll help them see, oh, okay, these are the people using this. So the more you use it, the more project leaders know. And it's all free. It's completely free for users and developers and project leaders, and always will be. And it's the money will be made connecting organizations that want to fund with people that want to get paid. And that part will come later. And the initial phase is just to help people build reputations and growth and all the stuff around that's not in GitHub or that's not in GitLab, all the other stuff that you can't see as a place to kind of document that and show that. So jump in, join the conversation. And then if you are looking for a job and you know C++, TypeScript, or Python, please let me know. We're definitely hiring. We're eager to find talented people all over the globe. Our office is Slack, and so anywhere you are in the world, you can participate. So thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here, and I appreciate the time. I'm not not sure if we have time for questions, but go ahead.
So, are there any questions in the audience for Travis?